Hey everybody, this is DJ Ravenwolf. You're tuned in to the best of hair on KCLA FM 99.3 Los Angeles and around the world on KCLAFM.com and thebestofhairradio.com as well. And it's freezing outside. It's about 40-something degrees. It's windy. The sun's out finally, but it's still pretty cold. Last week wasn't much better, but last week we had Playboy Playmate Tamara Whitmer on the show, and now, to keep you guys warm, we've got my buddy Jasmine in the studio, and hopefully we can still stay warm. She's all bundled up. I can't go.
I know, right? I'm like a little Eskimo over here.
Oh, man. Thanks for coming on the show. I know you're really busy, so we'll try to get to as many things as possible.
Sounds good.
Jasmine Dustin, born in New Hampshire, and it's kind of cool to have a fellow. When you call a 603 area code, wow! Awesome.
You never see that anymore, do you?
No, not out here. It's all 213-323. Mm-hmm. Usually it's my mom calling me, like, that's not mom. Man. Jasmine's been in a whole... I kept calling you Justin for some reason.
Everybody does that. You're not the only person. It's already happened to me once this morning.
Really?
In my last interview, yeah. So it's really... Yeah, it's common for people to do that. I don't know why.
It's crazy.
It's all good. No worries.
So basically, you came out here 10 years ago?
Yeah, a little over 10 years ago, right after I graduated high school. Mm-hmm. Packed up 3 suitcases, got on a plane with my, you know, high school sweetheart. Didn't know LA at all, had no car, no apartment, no nothing.
You got guts, man.
I got guts, man. And then within a week, you know, I was on Melrose shopping because someone, you know, had told me, oh, you got to go to Melrose. And got an agent right then and there on Melrose.
Jeez,
you know,
really?
Got scouted. And a couple weeks later, I had my first Fredericks of Hollywood campaign. So,
man.
I was one of the lucky ones, knock on wood.
Did you come out, you know, you said you came out here pretty much by yourself. For people that come out here, especially attractive girls coming out to Los Angeles, mm-hmm. there is that swamp and a bunch of snakes in the grass. I'll make you famous, and then they end up in porn or some weird thing.
Right, yeah.
And because you're doing modeling and a lot of other things, how many times has that happened to you out here?
I mean, it's happened quite a few. I mean, the whole casting couch, I mean, you know, it happens
all the time. It's still here,
folks. Directors or producers, or I'll do this or I'll do that, or get on my private jet and I'll, you know.
Yeah.
But, you know, thankfully I was kind of in a lot of relationships when I was out here. So, you know, I was kind of had my head pretty clear of that. You know, and my main focus was work. So.
Yeah.
And I was always busy. So, you know.
Well, that's, you know. It helps kind of having some kind of support group, at least like a reputable agent. That's another thing. You know, not many people know how to find the good guys.
Yeah, there's a lot of everybody's a manager in this town. Oh, everybody's got a manager.
Everybody with a camera is a photographer.
Exactly, you know. And everyone's a model because they got pictures on Instagram, you know.
Yeah.
Just, that's how it is.
Yeah.
It's LA, come on.
Man. But you seem to have got lucky. I mean, obviously you worked, but there's, you know, that navigation through the swamp,
mm-hmm.
and then finding the right people to put you in the right light and get you where you want to go, so you're going to have to have some kind of street smarts out here.
Oh, definitely. I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm sure I, you know, got caught up in a few times and people, you know, you get all excited. Oh my God, you know, he's going to put me in his movie. But, you know, a couple times on the phone or a couple times, you know, having that conversation, you're like, okay, no, this isn't happening. Next. Moving on over.
So what was it like for you? I mean, now obviously for me, this whole area is. I've grown up in New Hampshire, but I moved from Memphis to Arizona to Denver and here.
Okay.
And I'm used to different quirks, I guess. The Southerners have their little. It's like a big trailer park. Seabrook.
Well, New Hampshire is kind of white trash. Come on.
Seabrook.
A lot of us,
yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
No shame. It's all good. I still like to, you know, funnel beers and all that fun stuff. You know.
Yeah, but it's coming out to L.A. where it's a little bit of a culture shock. You've got basically like in Huntington Beach, and, you know, if you don't have money, they don't know who you are, you know.
Oh, true. Absolutely,
And it's, but honestly, the people I've met out here have been really cool. I've met a lot of really great people.
I mean, I found it hard to meet really good, true people, you know. Like, I'm just like a down-home girl, you know, living off, you know. I mean, it was really small town that we lived in. So.
Sure.
But yeah, it was hard that, like, that whole thing when you come to LA, just meeting good people. But I mean, now that I've been here so long, it's like, yeah. You know, I hang out at the dive bars. I don't hang out
there
at
you go. There you go. I love this girl. See, the East Coast girls know what to
See,
do.
Exactly.
All right. So for a lot of the listeners that, and there are a lot of female listeners as well, yeah. That are, you know, thinking about modeling or thinking about coming out here or just, you know, trying to make it, what are some of the things that they should really watch out for?
All the dirt bags. Because there's lots of them.
Yeah.
And I think it's really where you hang out, too. You know, when I was single, and, you know, you're going to the nice ritzy katanas and yeah. all these, you know, Hollywood places. That's where all the douchebags hang out that,
yeah.
you know, are going to promise you the world.
Sure.
You know, but now living here long enough, you're like, I can freaking catch that a mile away,
yeah,
you
yeah.
know? But I think if you're just smart enough, I mean, any person that just moves here, you're going to get excited and, you know, I mean, all that's going to be so exciting
sure.
to you at first anyways. So I think you kind of got to get over that new stage of being here and having that excitement of all that happening.
Right. Have your wits about you. What about as far as modeling agencies? There's a million of those, too, that, you know, some guy in the garage has a...
Yeah. Uh-huh. I mean, there's going to be agencies that, you know, try to hook you out to their, you know, French clients.
Yeah.
And then there's going to be photographers or the clients that, you know, try to get you Craigslist jobs for $100.
Like, yeah.
It's just all aspects here with agencies in LA. I mean, but that's anywhere, you know?
Yeah.
But I mean, if you have a strong book and, you know, you're a working model, it's, you know, yeah. a little bit different.
Do you have an agent or a manager or somebody?
Oh, I've got lots. Yeah, I've got representation, you know, manager in New York. And, you know, I've got my theatrical for TV and film. And then my manager here and my commercial and my prints.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah, I've got a whole, you know, lineup.
Well, Jasmine's been out there for a while, and she's been in magazines like GQ, Maxim, Allure, FHM, a whole bunch of different magazines.
Yeah.
So you and the television thing, you've been doing a lot of stuff, mm-hmm. and film, movies.
Yeah.
So it helps to have somebody there to say, okay, don't get on that project, but you need to go in this project.
Right, exactly.
Stay away from that guy. You know.
Even though sometimes you're like, no, I just want to do it, damn, you know?
Yeah.
But, you know, usually your agents know best, or, you know, that little voice in your head that says, oh, it sounds good right now, but, you know, 2 years down the line,
there's some, we were talking about that with Tamara last time, that when she did Playboy, she was young, and it was, you know, a lot of girls that are, not a lot of girls, there's a few that's their thing. It's like
yeah.
the holy grail of,
absolutely.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
But the parent side, it's like, you know, where they're like, they didn't like that.
Yeah.
You're out here by yourself pretty much, and I know my folks back home, you know, this is all, like, I made it, you know.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
And I've done a lot, but, I mean, what do your folks think of your career? Do they support you, or are they like, what are you doing?
No, I mean, at first, they didn't believe that I was coming to L.A., you know. They were like, oh, sure, you'll be back, you know, and here all these years later. But, no, they're so happy that I'm out here. I mean, I just went back for the holidays, and, of course, you know, my mom's like, when are we going to have babies?
Oh,
move
man.
Back, and, you know, I'm not ready yet, you know. A
yeah.
few more years, but then I'll settle down. But
well, you're doing your thing. You're, like, hitting your stride.
Yeah,
you know, you're really doing good.
This is my passion, and I love to do it. So if I was, you know, stuck in a hunky-bunk town in Florida, I'd be, like, pulling my hair out, not knowing what the hell to do with myself.
I've gone back home a couple of times, and honestly, it's really, there's really nothing much there. I mean, unless you're selling fried dough on the beach, there's nothing there, man.
I used to be a shot girl at Charlie Peppers.
So, oh, really?
Yeah, you know?
Oh, man.
That was fun. Mm-hmm.
I used to work down by the Hampton Beach Casino.
Okay.
There's Bob's Amusements. There was, you know, the shooting
gallery.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, a lot of that's still there.
Yeah.
I think some of the places burned down, all this other stuff, but that's still around. They redid the casino. They redid the shell.
The old
new.
Salt burnt down, but they moved that. Yeah.
But it was still cool to go home and just eat all that crappy food.
That's all I do. Fried everything.
Yeah.
Fried clams and lobster rolls all day.
See,
I love
this
it.
This is the girl, man.
I like to eat. I'm a model, but I can eat, so.
All you California girls eating grass and twigs and sticks and stuff.
Yeah, not me. I piss people off all day long because I like to eat and I like to drink.
Yeah.
So.
When you're doing shoots and stuff like that, I never really got a chance to look at any of this stuff, but I mean, I imagine you work out at all? Do you just have a high metabolism?
I have a really high metabolism. Thank you, freaking Lord. Like I said, 'cause I love me. I'm a huge foodie. I work out usually 3 to 4 days a week.
Right.
You know, do Pilates or whatever, but nothing too crazy. I mean, I'm shooting a big shoot here in a couple of weeks, so I'm going to probably turn it up a few notches here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do they ever ask you, hey, you need to put on a few pounds or you need your
When I was younger, when I first moved out here, I went through a spell and I was just super tiny. So, yeah, they were always like, all right, you got to gain five.
When for those of you listening, when you come out here to do a commercial shoot or anything like that, you're not the only one applying for the job. Yeah. You're going to hear you're too tall, you're too small, you're too short, you're too fat, you're too thin. I had friends here that are Latino. They say you're not Latino enough.
And I get told no 5 times a day every day. Yeah. So, you know, it's just we get denied, I mean, more than any other job, I would assume, you know?
Yeah.
Exactly. Oh, you're not cute enough. Oh, your hair's too blonde. Oh, wait, no, that's not the right color blonde.
See? So it's one of those things where you really have to have a thick skin and don't take it personally. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, a lot of these magazines and stuff, like they have a certain image. If it's a commercial for a car or something like that, they're trying to hit a certain demographic. So they want a certain look.
Yeah.
You know, they know exactly what they want. Even though you can dye your hair and make yourself, they want...
Yeah, exactly. No. They've got exactly what they want, you know, pictured in their head, so...
How do you deal with the rejections and stuff?
I mean, I just went through a really bad one, damn it.
Really?
Ooh. Oh, yeah. I was on hold for a really big TV show since before the holidays.
Right.
We were supposed to be signing contracts at the end of this month, you know, meeting with really the biggest agency in L.A., and... got a call a few days ago that I got released.
Aww.
But that was like, you know, that was like deal breaking. That was going to be a big like money maker changer in the biz. So yeah, that sucked. But now that's the second or third.
But you're in LA. I mean, there's TV show, pilot season's coming up. I mean, you got there's tons of stuff.
Yeah. I mean, it's the big ones hurt. You know what I mean? The ones that you know you're going to be buying the $5 million houses with.
remember me.
Yeah, you know. So those are the big ones that hurt. But the every other day when you know, commercials and print job, it's like whatever. That's you know, that's the nature of the beast. So.
So you got a pretty level head about a lot of this stuff. Well, you've been doing it for a long time, so you're kind of used to it.
Yeah.
So for those of you listening, if you're maybe you're just starting out modeling, maybe you haven't been in it for a very long time, you cannot take this stuff personally. You have to understand. You might be the hottest thing on two legs, but when you come to L.A., there's a whole bunch of those.
Yeah, there's 4,000 of them. Just as cute, honey.
Oh, my God. Tell me about the TV stuff. Now, when did you start getting involved with that?
Well, I was doing modeling for, you know, when I moved here, and then I got picked up for Deal or No Deal.
Yeah.
Which I think Tamara was on as well, wasn't she?
Tamara was on, and I had another girl here, Brooke... her name.
Juan Brooke?
Yeah.
Okay.
She was on there. She's one of them.
Yeah. So after I did Deal or No Deal, I just loved being on set. I really enjoyed that. I booked a film and then so I didn't do second season. And then I don't know, that became my passion.
Right.
I started dating an actor and I don't know, he always would help me and I would love being on set and it was just something completely different than modeling.
Yeah.
So after Deal or No Deal, that kind of became, you know, my main focus.
There's a little bit more work involved in this.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. I talked to a lot of the models where they say, well, yeah, it can be makeup and hair and sit like this and hold that pose and all this other crap. Mm-hmm. And then the TV seems a bit more technical.
Absolutely. You know. Yeah. There's a lot more work that goes into it, you know.
Do you think you see yourself as maybe a director or producer at some point? Because you're kind of getting the hands-on thing.
I don't know. I think that after this whole, you know, after I'm done with the modeling and acting, I'll probably start really concentrating on the animal charity that I started.
Yeah.
But not for a little bit, you know?
Well, yeah.
Give me a few more years.
You're doing your thing.
I don't have enough wrinkles yet.
We can Photoshop those out.
No wrinkles yet.
I'm getting really good with Photoshop, man. The television world is a friend of mine, Lisa Belfour, she designs for a lot of the singers, Beyonce, LL Cool J, all these people. She was talking with LL about, you know, the show that he's, I think it's CSI, one of those cop movies.
Mm-hmm.
As a rapper and stuff like that, they were asking him, well, you know, you've got all this money making music and all this other stuff. And he said, well, honestly, at like Jay-Z's level, at Snoop's level, at his level, that's okay.
Yeah.
But there's nothing like that TV money, man.
I know, it's so true, right? It's such a different lifestyle, too, just going to set. I don't know. It's just fun. I just enjoy it. I mean, don't get me wrong. I love going to big photo shoots. If it's like, you know, I'm doing the cover of something and everything's, you know, all about me for the day. But, you know, those catalog shoots where you got to shoot 50 outfits in a day.
Oh, God.
That's not exactly my dream job.
Yeah.
That's just to pay the bills.
Yeah. You only stand in your underwear for so long.
Yeah,
and you're like,
exactly.
I gotta go.
I liked when I did Fredericks of Hollywood. That was fun. That was enjoyable.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Those are fun jobs.
I got a friend of mine coming in here a little while. We're doing this thing with green screen. She's a hot blonde, and her name's Sydney. And I told we're gonna mess with people. Just tell them, look, Sydney's got a new tattoo on her crotch, and she's gonna show it on camera. And so when they tune in, she got a pair of green panties from Fredericks.
Oh shit!
So we're gonna chroma key the whole thing out. It'll be invisible, and we're gonna get all the hate mail.
Oh, that's funny. I love it.
Yeah, we're gonna have fun with folks.
People
always ask, how many listeners you got? Well, piss them off and you'll find out.
Yeah, exactly. Or make them really excited, one or the other.
Yeah. They'll tune in for that and then they'll get mad because it's invisible.
Oh, shoot.
And then as the cameras pass to me and then they go back to her, while it's talking to me, she's going to put like green lipstick on. So pieces of her will start disappearing.
Disappearing. All best places about her.
Oh, yeah. It'll be awesome.
That's funny.
So do you miss home at all? I mean, going back a couple times, there's really nothing there. It's all the same stuff, and it's quiet, and it's just, but, you know, it's still home.
It's home. My parents actually moved to Florida when I moved out to L.A., now, you know, we just have our summer place there, so we go, you know, 1 or 2 weeks.
Right.
But that's plenty for me.
Yeah.
You know, I go there, I get my lobster and my seafood in, and see a couple, you know, a few friends, and go to the favorite restaurants, but then after that I'm like, all right, get me the hell back home.
Yeah.
I call this home, you know.
Yeah, this is home to me. Every time I've come out here, I lived on Huntington Beach, I've come out here a few times, and this just felt like it's where I should have been my whole life.
Yeah,
you know, fit, you know, like, I've dated so many girls, models and actresses, and just everybody's here.
Right. Oh, absolutely.
And I've met so many cool people. Everybody said, oh, they're a bunch of a-holes, and I'm, not really. I've met some great folks. So it just feels right. You know, my mom's come out here and it's fun. We're, you know, for Christmas, we're out here at the Grove eating dinner in our t-shirt and jeans, and everybody back home was freezing it. Like, yeah, give me my palm trees, buddy.
Yeah, right. Exactly. So true.
Jasmine is, also involved in a few other things. You can see her on the television show Get Out, where she travels around the world doing high adventure sports and all kinds of stuff. You, I can imagine what a first date with you would be like, you know. We're going bungee jumping.
Unfortunately, it's off the air now. We didn't get picked up. It was on 11 or 12 seasons. So, but it was an absolute dream job. I mean, you get paid to go on vacation to absolutely beautiful places.
Yeah.
As long as you could wear a bikini, then that's where we would travel to. So, I mean, you name it, we've been there.
And what was some of the sports that you're doing? Like surfing or what?
Oh, I mean, you'd go surfing. You'd go swimming with sharks. You'd go scuba diving. You'd go bungee jumping. You'd go rappelling off, you know, crazy mountains. I mean, we did it all. It was amazing.
What was some of the nuttiest stuff you did on that show? I mean,
it just depended if it involved a lot of tequila or not. There were certain times we'd go to Mexico and tequila would always get, you know, thrown in the mix, and then
That's the best. I've done drunk radio here where, you know, a lot of people come into the studio and they're kind of nervous and they're freaking out. So I give them a few shots of Jack Daniels and they just relax.
The best way.
So, for TV, let's get Jasmine drunk and turn the camera on.
I'll take a couple shots. If I have a really big audition that I have to be, you know, crazy, the heroin addict or something, or, you know, oh, yeah, you better believe I'm taking two shots before I go in that room. You better believe it.
This girl knows how to do it, man.
Yes.
Okay, we got about 10 minutes left. Let's talk about the animal rescue and stuff that you do. You're really big on that. I've got a lot of friends. My friend Silence back in New Jersey, she does animal rescue for no-kill shelters.
Yeah.
They'll pick up dogs like in the Mid-South. They'll have a chain where they'll drive it so many miles and then the other guy takes it. There's been, I dated a girl back in New Hampshire for the, she worked for the SPCA for like 25 years. Her name was Sue Carney. And she does a lot of dog training now. She left the SPCA, does her own thing with consulting and stuff like that. lot of people were bringing in animals that they supposedly rescued off the streets or stray cats or whatever, and they'll dump them off at the shelter where the shelter has no room.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, there's a lot of things you can find online. There are shelters that have hookups with other ones that help out.
Yeah.
But you can't just drop off an animal and say, hey, here you go. And because a lot of them basically get put to death because there's nothing, they can't do anything.
Yeah, LA is really pretty sad. LA, I mean, it's just every day is killing thousands and thousands of dogs. 2 years ago, I started a company called Red Carpet Rescue.
Okay.
And I tried to get a few of the girls from Deal or No Deal together that all have the same passion that I did.
Right.
And we would all rescue them and foster them. I saved 15 myself last year from
Good.
Death row from being killed. I have 4 little ones at home.
Oh, that's awesome.
That were going to be killed. So, yeah, I have 4. I'm actually saving a pit bull this afternoon for my ex from New Hampshire.
Right.
He's taking one. But now, about right before the holidays, so I guess, probably maybe like 5 or 6 months ago, I started a company, organization called Models and Mutts.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a group of well-known models that all have fame that we can kind of use our fame to bring awareness of rescuing animals. So, you know, we did a launch party where we raised money for the animals of Hurricane Sandy.
Sure.
We had a food drive where we got a bunch of dog food and then we donated it to a rescue out in Southern California, a couple hours away. So we do different things, you know.
Yeah.
We volunteer at pet adoptions and things like that. So,
right.
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of really enjoying it.
What's... for most people that don't understand what animal rescue is, what is some of the hardest things, or maybe that something that you can impart to the, it's you're not like just, I don't know, I've done this so many times. There are people out there that claim to be animal rescuers, or they adopt animals and then they sell them to companies for makeup
for
testing
money, absolutely, and I mean, the breeders are really bad out here, and the pet shops and everything else, and the dog mills. It's really sad. But Models and Mutts, we're just trying to let people know that you can foster an animal, or, you know what
right.
I mean? Even if it's for 2 weeks, that means 2 weeks for the shelter or somebody else to find it at home before it's killed.
Right.
I mean, there's so many shelters here in LA that just kill thousands and thousands and thousands, you know, over millions of dogs in California each year. So... but yeah, check out modelsandmutts.com. It's really hot, sexy models. We pose we pose naked with the dog.
Really?
Yeah, you'll have to check it out. So, you know, anybody that's wanting to help out in that kind of, you know, thing.
I want to check out the naked.
Models.com, baby. We got a Facebook page too. So, and it's all kinds of hot cuties.
Check out those puppies, baby. Yeah. What are some of the maybe the misconceptions that people have about animal rescue? I know there's a lot where they think it's, you know, you're getting, like, for instance, pit bulls. They think pit bulls are just the nastiest, ugliest, you know,
that's
mean
what I'm
dogs.
This afternoon.
And I've got friends that have pit bulls that are just.
Yeah, they've got a bad rap. It's really sad, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. There's a lot of counties now in the United States that are actually going into people's homes and killing their dog if it has
really?
A pit bull in it. Yeah. They're doing it overseas right now, too, but it's really, really sad. So they're trying to ban it, but, yeah, I forget where it is, but, yeah, there's a couple counties, and
see,
they're just going into your house and killing the dog.
They can't do that.
Yeah, they can. It's really
Why?
It's unbelievable, because they're banning pit bulls, so it doesn't matter if it's a family dog or not. It's awful. Really, really sad.
In the United States.
Mm-hmm. Which is crazy, I know. Yeah. Awful.
I that pisses me off.
Yeah, I know.
I've got friends. Well, a friend of mine, Sarah Scar, she has a beautiful gray and white pit. His name is Storm. Just the gentlest dog.
They are.
You
that's
know.
The thing. I mean, you might get one or two bad ones here and there, but usually they're getting, you know, it's usually a reason for it.
If they're
know?
Bad, it's because the owners have no idea what they're doing with them. They get it.
The
oh, he's pretty,
exactly.
And that's it.
Mm-hmm.
Or they're doing it to purposely piss the dog. You know, they want a guard dog.
Yeah.
So they get a dog that they mistreat and make him as vicious
as
possible.
Absolutely. And it's their own fault.
Yeah.
It's really sad.
It's a lot of these dogs, first of all, back in the 80s, it used to be Dobermans. They thought Dobermans were the nasty Rottweilers and Dobermans.
Yeah.
And it's not the dog. It's the sick
it's
son
the
of a
owners.
Bitch on the end of the leash that's doing this stuff to these animals that are pissing them, you know. You got to remember, folks, a dog is a pack animal. When you bring a dog into your home, you become its pack. So you have to learn how to adjust to the dog. The dog is, he'll adjust anywhere he goes. But you're bringing him into your home. So now he's part of your family. He's part of your pack. And you can't chain him up out in the yard.
Yeah.
That's
well, that's the thing.
You know,
you see a lot, that's pretty much what people use pit bulls for.
Yeah, you know? Dogs are social animals. You chain them up out in the yard, and there's nobody. So yeah, he's pissed
he's
off.
He's gonna be pissed off.
Chain you out in the
yard. Hopefully it'll be the owner. But.
Yeah, chain you out in the yard. See how you like it.
Exactly.
If you're going to get a dog, if you're going to get any kind of an animal, make sure you do some research about it. Find out the breed. I mean, a lot of these animals are bred for hunting. They're bred for running. They're bred for a bunch of different things. Don't get a hyper dog if you live in a little one-bedroom apartment.
Work 12 hours a day.
You have to have something that's, you know, just because it's pretty doesn't make it a good pet. You have to make sure you can handle this thing and that dog isn't or cat is in the right environment. Because it's not fair to go and grab an animal and then dump it off at a shelter in a month.
And that's the thing, and you're seeing so many of these poor senior animals, just, you know, a family's always getting too old, so they dump it off at the shelter. And I see that every day.
Yeah.
It's your family pet for 10 years, and now because it's, you know, not as active, you're just going to throw it away. It's unbelievable.
My friend Susan had a woman come up with a dog that they had gotten, I don't know, maybe for Christmas. The woman drives up in a Mercedes, has her nails done, gold chains, and why are you bringing the dog back? Well, we can't afford it.
Oh, for Christ.
We can't afford
it. Out of copter tire.
Yeah, that was the excuse. And I'm like, you know, people
that's
are just
bullshit.
Retarded.
Mm-hmm.
Retarded.
That's bullshit,
So pimp out the websites again, because I really want people. I'm going to put that up on the video as well.
Yeah, absolutely. You guys come and check us out. Like I said, it's a lot of beautiful, beautiful, well-known models that are really giving back. It's modelsandmutts.com, and then we also have a Facebook, Models and Mutts.
Right.
If anybody has any questions or want a certain dog, you know, any of us can help you out in trying to find that as well.
Can they get a hold of you, like,
absolutely.
On a website?
Yeah. And you can also find me, just my personal Facebook is just Jasmine Dustin, J-S-M-I-N-E, Dustin, D-U-S-T-I-N, and then also Twitter is the same as well.
I dated a girl in high school named Donna Dustin.
Oh, yeah?
There's a lot of Dustins out there. She was in Hampton Falls.
Oh, see?
A long time
New
ago.
Hampshire babies.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad you're out here, man. I know you're busy. You know, you got a lot of things to do. When you are kind of relaxed, just come on back and we'll have margaritas or something.
All right, I'm in.
Oh yeah. It's really funny. That the radio show starts off really good, and then, you know, we start mispronouncing people's names.
Oh shit, it's all right. Everybody understands.
Yeah.
Having a good time.
All right. Jasmine, come back anytime you're ready.
Awesome. Thank you.
You don't even have to promote anything. If you just want to come back and just hang out.
Cool. I'm in.
We'll play 80s metal and just get drunk.
I like
and
it.
It's
We're
fun.
In.
All right, guys. Check out Jasmine Dustin and get a hold of her. Do you have I guess your Facebook page got hacked, but now you've got the new one up and it's ready.
Yeah, I've got the new one, and it's Jasmine Dustin. Same with Twitter, and then the Models and Mutts. I run that Facebook page as
Very cool.
So anything you guys can get a hold of me on.
Yeah, so check her out. And if you guys are looking to adopt an animal, make sure you get a hold of her.
Yes, please.
And she will steer you in the right direction, because, you know, it's all about the love. Yeah. This is DJ Ravenwolf for the best of hair radio.com. We'll see you guys all again next time. Hopefully it'll be a little bit warmer. And we'll get some alcohol in here too. All right, guys. See you next time. Bye.